Okay, guys, it's our second week on the material testing, and it's going to be our second lecture. And let me remind you again, why do we need to study the material testing? Okay, again, let me take you back. In the future, you are going to be the engineer, maybe the design engineer. The design engineer, you got to be the one who specify the material property, select type of materials, okay, and then use those type of materials and mechanical property combined with the design code and building code, and then the end product going to be the floor plan of the building, those kind of thing, okay, and then as the site engineer. Okay, you are the one who taking the responsibility of the construction of a building. Then you got to check the materials that deliver to your site. It's going to follow what in the design. You got to do the testing only to check it up. If for somehow you found that the material is under specification, what you going to do? You order 30 tons of steel, shipping by A.T. Mueller, and list your size. And you test this. The steel won't pass the specification, such as TAS-1208 for hot roll steel. That's going to cost 900,000 baht. How do you do? Reject it, not refund. Reject it, okay? And then the company gonna do refund or gonna do send a new one to you. Okay, that's going to be what you should do. Okay, so first, as an engineer, you must have the knowledge of the mechanical property of the construction material, especially steel and concrete and timber, in order to select and use its material and property effectively and appropriately. And second one, you got to have the knowledge of the material testing in order you to check if the material follow the specification or standard given in the structural analysis and design. Now, the pictures here occur in Kolat like 30 years, 31 years ago. It's a collapse of a hotel, okay, by a mistake of the design and construction, board design and construction. And then, in short, as a civil engineer, if you lack the knowledge, what we have mentioned, you may cause two big things. One, the structure gonna be expensive, okay? If the problem of the second, if you make the structure that is too big, using too low mechanical property of the materials, the size of the structural, such as steel member, gonna be huge, right? So that's going to be more expensive with too large structure. This one actually have another size. Good, because it can endure larger forces and it's maybe long lasting, such as what? Pyramid, okay, that's 4,000 years ago. What you have in your country, that's like 1,000 years ago, built. Those kind of structure is in the second type. And the second one, it's going to be, one is expensive, it's going to be dangerous, okay? The dangerous thing may cause damage, okay, to the structure, such as it's going to have really large deformation, such as the bridge that I used to show you, okay? There is a small vehicle passing bridge with very large defection. It won't fail, but its function is not good. So you got to put more money to repair it, to fix it, to strengthening it. Okay. And then in the other side, if it's not failure, you got to pay more money to repair on or strengthening it. In the other side, this is bad. Like in the pictures, it's caused the damage or failure of the structure, and then it's caused the loss of life. Okay, or so the property. That is bad, right? As the engineer, your duty is like military man, protect the people. Okay, from those kind of things. Now, let me move to this one. This is very nice example of the seven story RC and PC building. RC, reinforced concrete, developed about 200 years ago. Okay, and then PC is talking about prestress concrete. It's only popular in Thailand for only 40 or 50 years ago. And then what we have is, this is a typical 3D model of the structure. And I should mention you as a new generation of civil engineer, you should be able to model it. By using what? The knowledge from graphic code for civil engineering, you study with whom? Ajahn Nice. Okay, that's really nice. He is now a monk. Okay, anyway, you got to be able to. And then by doing that, you got to specify types of materials and their specification. After that, you got to use building code and design code to do it. Okay, now thinking you are a new engineer, and first we're talking about the design criteria. First one, design standard. Okay, and you assume it. There is two things in Thailand. One is building regulation by Ministry of Interior, and the second one is building regulation for BMA, Bangkok Metropolitan Administration. If you are Filipino, it's maybe Manila Metropolitan Administrator, those kind of thing. Okay, this is the legal document. You guys got to use it with the careful. Okay, just follow it. Most of the detail in this legal document provide you with minimum requirement. Okay, you may use better than that. Now, talking to 1.2, this building going to be reinforced concrete and the prestress concrete. The design can follow the Engineering Institute of Thailand. If I said, what the meaning of EAT? Multiple choice, right? You got to be able to know that. That's going to be Engineering Institute of Turkey. No, it's Thailand, okay? And then for this one we call it design code, okay? For RC and PC. This one we call it from theory of structure, building code, okay? Building code is a legal document, okay? And the design code is going to be some kind of what? Some kind of technical document. And then for the steel construction in Thailand, again, you follow Engineering Institute of Thailand. But for American, you have AISC, American Institute of Steel and Construction. How about the ACI? ACI over here. How about ACI? American Concrete Institute. Okay, most of Thai code developed from American code. And nowadays, we develop a lot from Japanese code also. Okay. Now, let me move you guys to the second portion. On the second portion, we're talking about the design parameter. And let me show you in Thailand, for the steel design, we have what's so called ASD design. This is going to be the allowable stress or strength design. Based upon this one, we use factor of safety to reduce the mechanical property of the materials. But for the dead load, we just do the combination of dead load plus live load directly. And then the RC one, the reinforced concrete one, you study, you also use this kind of concept. However, this building isn't. It's used one. It's used the ultimate strength design. Okay, over here is to have the word ULTMATE. All the ultimate strength design, you got to put the factor. Let's see, nowadays it's changed to 1.4 for the dead load. It's changed to 1.7 to the live load. So the load combination of this one will be such as 1.4 dead load plus 1.7 live load. This is going to be the new way of design of the building. You will learn it in the RC design 2, another subject. You study the old one first, and then you follow with the new one. Okay. And now there are factors to multiply the load. Not only that, they also introduce the strength reduction factor. But the strength reduction factor different from different types of member. You may see the ultimate strength design is a lot more complicated than the allowable stress design, and it should be close to the real world problem. Okay, so in the future, I think, okay, in the US now, they use all ultimate strength design, both steel and RC and PC. But Thailand is in development. So when you study engineering in Thailand, you got to study a lot. Anyway, it's good to know the good old day. Okay. And then I move you to the third topic. We're going to talking about what the materials used in the construction. Okay. Following this one, just zoom in. Okay. The detail cupcake gonna be first concrete. This is the concrete from typical structural element such as column, such as footing, such as here. Okay. That's gonna be what? Ultimate compressive cylinder strength. The concrete specimen can be cylinder and can be cube. They are different. Okay. Over here, they specify cylinder 240. This one is for typical reinforced concrete. And then if you get down to this one, there is the floor. Okay. The floor, same thing as the slab. Okay. This one made by hysteresis concrete. Then you can see the strength of the hysteresis concrete pre-20. The strength of the RC concrete 240. Why? In the same building, they use different concrete. Because for the hysteresis concrete, it's a new technology. It requires higher mechanical property. Okay, and then it can resist larger forces when we're talking about the same size, thickness of the slab. And then you also should mention about the modulus of elasticity, higher ultimate compressive strength of concrete, you get higher modulus of elasticity. This won't occur in the steel. Okay. For the steel, the modulus of elasticity always the same most of the time. Okay, not different like this one. And then move you to further one, talking about the Liba. Okay, that's the first. This is the first law coming. Liba, R-E-B-A-R. What is the Liba? Liba is the bar that's used to reinforce the steel. It have what so called this one. Okay, this grade SR24. This is going to be for ROUND. This is going to be for the round bar. The surface of this bar going to be smooth. Okay, and then it has the strength of 2400 KSC or 240 megapascal and the grade called SR24. Okay, and then you have another type of rebar. Now you have the bar, and then you have this type of non-uniform external surface. Okay, it's going to have this one. They built this one to be what so called deformed bar, and then the surface is not smooth. Okay, just smooth. In order to what? In order for the concrete to bond to the deformed bar better than bonding into the round bar. Okay, we have this kind of unsmooth surface to make the bonding between the steel and the concrete better. So most of the time, this can be used in the what so called main reinforcement. And how about the round bar? What the uses of it? What uses of round bar? It's gonna be, yeah, that's called stirrup. Okay, that's one called stirrup. And the stirrup used to resist the shear force. The main reinforcement used to resist the tension mainly and compression also. Okay, the function of the material, even though they are the same, but it's different. Now, let me move to the most important one, prosthesis. Okay, reinforcement. That's going to be something called stand. Okay, the stand is a kind of cable, and you can see this is the maximum tensile strength 1860 megapascal compared to the SR 2400 compared to the SD standard deform bar. That's 4000. It means what? Prosthesis concrete reinforcement have at least 4 times higher strength than the deform bar. So prosthesis concrete gonna be used a lot in the near coming future for sure. Okay, and then if your country didn't have a good company on the prosthesis concrete structure, it's better you to study master degree on this one and go back to set up a company in your country. As far as I know, Filipino also have very good, okay, skill on the prosthesis concrete. I have a friend working with Italian Thai Development. The ITD have the project in Philippines. They build the elevated highway and use a lot of prosthesis concrete. But I'm not sure about Myanmar, about that, okay? But in Yangon, I should be have those kind of technology. But in far away area, okay, you may not that one. Anyway, coming to this one, we end up with various types of materials. And then we come to what? The top, this is the reinforcement for the RC and PC. On the bottom, you have what? You have steel. But now, steel has the grade of A36. อาจารย์ that's different from SR24 and different from SD40 yes this call structural steel not the reinforcement this one we call it structural steel this one structural steel you're going to use the proportion in the study of RC design in the study of PC design but you're going to use this portion of the property in the steel design different subjects okay different type of steel okay so we have a lot of steel as I mentioned before and then you also have the welding and the welding have the grade of E70XX it can be E60XX it can be E80XX okay this one select the typical E70XX in the steel design when you study it you got to know how to weld the structure together you got to know how to bolt the structure together right okay that's kind of pattern and then the last one we talking about the pie over here is the diamond pie that's going to be different from bullet pie okay the diamond pie we have the way to impact the pie diving it to the ground but for the bullet pie you have the skill okay and then take the soil bore the hole and then take the soil out and then you have the steel cage put the steel into the hole and pour the concrete into it that's called bore pie okay and the bore pie also have different property compared to the diamond pie there are many things for you to understand it okay and then this pie have rectangular section and the size of 0.3 times 0.3 1 foot times 1 foot okay and then there are the other thing about and let me take you to the loading in the theory of structure we have two types of loading right dead load and live load again we have the cell weight of RC element we have cell weight of PC element we have cell weight of steel element all of them they are density of the materials okay and remember if we have a beam section for example for the last one if we have the beam section of the T we have the steel reinforcement over here we can compute the weight per meter of this beam right that's very first time when we study about loading right and then we have what also dead load now is separate into layer of brick wall okay this is single layer this is double layer the double layer supposed to be larger than single layer you have two layer and then when we talking about this kind of structural component the unit gonna be kilogram force per square meter not the density okay and then let me move to the live load live load depend on what live load depend on what the uses the occupancy of the structure okay it may be office okay it may be house those kind of thing the load gonna be different okay so as the engineer you got to select it and then you can see parking is gonna be larger than stair and larger than typical area this gonna be for residential building okay and then the parking gonna be 400 gonna be larger why yes yeah this is only the room right only a family room but for the stair for the walkway there are more people okay and then for the parking you're gonna have car to park on it and for that one we also have this one wind load as I mentioned wind load you can take it directly from the value over here the value over here what you take it from the value over here from the theory of structure. I have mentioned about this before. For 0 to 10, 50 kilogram force per square meter. For higher, it's changed to like 80. So higher building get higher wind load. That's going to follow Bangkok Metropolitan Administrator regulation. Okay, this is from the BMA. But for Philippines, for sure, your wind going to be larger than this because you are very prone to typhoon, those kind of large forces of the wind. In Myanmar, it depends on what are you living. If you're living near Bangladesh, okay, you may have hit it by those kind of typhoon also. Okay, but if you live deep north to the China, okay, the strong wind will change to some kind of wind else. Anyway, that's going to be what you should learn. And I link the theory of structure to the material testing. And I should send all of this to steel design, RC design 1, RC design 2, pre-stresses concrete design. Do you guys feel more as an engineer? All of these are technical terms, guys. The ME student don't know about this. Only the civil engineer talking this kind of technical term. Okay? Be proud of it. You're going to talk with only for some few group of people. This guy. Okay? The mechanical engineer use the steel, but they use different type of steel. Okay? And the wording may be also different, such as round bar. They said rod. R-O-D. Okay, not bar. They said rod. And most of the time, the ME won't have the deform bar, those kind of thing, because deform bar developed for the concrete to have the bone into it. So, why do you study concrete technology? Do your ajan explain to you about that? You have the class with him, right? Yeah, why do you need to study the concrete technology? Yeah, it's a main bedroom for building. That's the same word at Ajahn Sithichai. It should be have something more deeper. We're talking about the mechanical property of the concrete already, right? Now, how to mix the concrete to get the ultimate compressive strength of 240 kilogram per square centimeter, or 320 or 800 kilogram per square centimeter. That's for the concrete technology. And for sure, if you prefer to mix the concrete to get 80 megapascal or 90 megapascal, that's going to be two or three times larger than normal concrete. You got to put some special chemical into it, such as water retarding agent. You got to put some special stuff, such as silica foam, those kind of thing into the concrete. Okay. But you got to start with a typical concrete design. It's called concrete mix design. This is the example. And every concrete company, this one for the TPI concrete company, we have many big ones, SCG, SSSG, TPI, those kind of huge company. And each company also require engineer to work with them. Okay. And I will relate this one to the type of manual testing later. Okay. Again, why do you study concrete technology? At least to be able to. Yeah, you can do the concrete mix design. And it's have the word of what? Design. Okay. That means you may list the result by the design. How about mixing the high, very high strength concrete of 1,200 kilogram force per square centimeter? That's possible, right? The Burj Khalifa use more higher strength than that. Okay, as the young engineer, building very high, high building, 1 mile tower, those kind of thing. Frank Lloyd Wright talking about that 100 years ago. But now, a day, the people cannot reach that tall yet. Okay, maybe reach that tall within you guys, one of you over here. Okay, coming to the second part of the theory of structure, I ask you to what? Use the knowledge that you learn from engineering, graphic. Okay, use the knowledge that you learn from the CE. What's the name of it? Yeah, civil engineering, graphic, those kind of thing. You got to be able to change from 2D, 3D, 3D, 2D to the 2D model. And you may thinking about it. And let me check you. What is this one? It's going to be the hole, right? Or the void. It's going to be what? Huh? Elevator core. Okay, elevator core. It have the core. That's elevator can move up and down. And when we're talking about the in-traffic, don't forget about this kind of identification. For the horizontal line, it's going to be number. And for the vertical line, it's going to be letter. Okay, that's going to be what civil engineering uses. The mechanical engineering won't use this kind of convention, sign convention. Okay, any question on this? No question? How come Ajahn Atibai so good? I can explain so good like this one. Anyway, bad practice may cause loss of life and damage. Okay, this also again occurred like 31 years ago in more than that, right? That is going to be 33, 34 years ago, has caused many people die and injure. And then the engineer who take responsibility of this failure sentenced for 37 years in jail. And then not only in Thailand, this is occur in America. That's due to the unexpected snow load, okay, in Connecticut of the United States of America. And then due to the unexpected snow load caused the failure of this city hall. And this one recently is occurred in like 24 years ago in the US. This one caused in the US, not in Thailand. It's what? It's the failure of the pedestrian bridge. Okay. This is due to the bad construction because you didn't do a good construction. So the water penetrated the cable, cause is rusty for 5 years. And then the connection, okay, of the cable failed. Then the whole structure collapsed. And that's for the sample of the best practice, bad design for the first one, or the also the best construction controlling procedure. And then the second one in Connecticut, that's occur due to the I think not due to the, because it said modest snow road, it may be caused by best construction, and this one also. Anyway, what types of material property we interested in? Okay, last time when we talking about the rubber band, we interested in what? Size and shape. Okay, we use the vernier to measure the thickness, the width. So that's going to be the first one. And the second one, mechanical property. What a strength. What is the strength of the concrete? Let's call it F palm sub C, ultimate compressive strength. Okay. What's going to be the strength of the steel? Let me change it to F sub Y, as I just mentioned previously. But in our study, we call it sigma sub Y. And let's make it equivalent to each other. Okay. How about the stiffness? That's going to be modulus of elasticity. How about the toughness? morass of toughness. The energy the material can absorb until its failure. Okay, and that's all for our our focus on this subject. There are also mechanical properties of the materials that's interested by some other field, such as electrical and mechanical property. That's maybe for the electrical engineering, telecommunication engineering, those kind of things. Okay, not us. Okay, let me move over here. What the definition of the strength? Okay, it's going to be in chapter 4. Okay, I too said strength is ability of the material to resist the external forces without failure. For the steel, we call failure as the yielding, not separation into two pieces. The yielding is the failure of the steel. Okay. How about the concrete? After it's reached the ultimate strength, ultimate stress, we call it failure because we use F palm sub C. Okay. Because we use sigma sub Y for the steel as the failure. Now, that's going to be these two things. Okay. And how about the stiffness? It's ability to resist the deformation of the, sorry, the ability of the material to resist the deformation under the applied load. Large force cause small deformation. Okay, that's material is really stiff, right? That can be the steel. Small force cause very large deformation. That's going to be less stiffness, such as rubber. Okay, so for this one, we use the modulus of elasticity. And the modulus of elasticity is going to be the change in stress divided by the change in the strain. We measure the slope. Okay, and based upon this one, based on this one, which one gonna have larger E between wood and steel? The slope of steel much more larger than slope of the wood. So stiffness of the steel is significantly larger than the wood. Okay. Now, elasticity is ability of the material when it's deformed and return to its original length. Talking about the rubber, okay? Plasticity is ability of the material that have what's so called large permanent deformation. For material that have large plasticity, gonna have large permanent deformation before failure. And then how about the energy? The energy is going to be the area under certain strain diagram. This is the energy the material, the wood material can take. And this is going to be the energy the steel can take, the area. Okay. This is called modulus of resilience. Okay. It's the area at what? U sub R. This is U sub R. 1/2 sigma PL epsilon PL is ability of the material to absorb energy, okay, during linear elastic behavior. Okay, and you can see wood has the energy absorption capacity close to the steel if you do an approximate calculation. And you may see we use a lot of wood to support the railway. When the railway, you have the wood. Now it's gonna change to the concrete, okay? But in the past, we have wood. So wood will absorb energy and vibration during the train move. Okay, and then that's gonna be the stress strain diagram of various materials I call it is kind of fingerprint of each material. Okay, me and you have different fingerprint, steel and wood also. Any question? Oh, no question. That's so good. Go to classification of the melanin testing. Okay. It can be classified into three types. But the most important one is going to be testing for control. Okay. This is going to be the test to investigate if the manufactured material have properties as specified. And it can be separated into two types. First, when you work as the engineer in the company such as CPAC, okay, you are the engineer working with the manufacturer for the TPI, polyene, those kind of company in the SYS, Siam Yamato Steel Industry. When you're working in a company like that, you got to test the specimen to for the QC. Okay, this one for the QC, quality control. If the quality control is good, most of the material will pass all the specification, right? And then your product gonna be a good product. Then, as the size engineer, after the manufacturer send the steel bars to your construction site for 30 tons, you're going to sample some of them and put it into the universal testing machine and do the test, follow the TIS, Thailand Industrial Standard, and all of the required property, such as for the steel, sigma sub y, sigma sub u, e, and percent elongation must pass all the minimum requirement. Okay. And then, can it pass only one? No, it's got to pass all four. Okay. Even one of that won't pass. You got to, again, reject out of your construction site. Okay. You won't use it. Now, talking about our head of School of Civil Engineering, Ajahn Thirawat. Ajahn Thirawat developed lightweight concrete. Okay. He developed that basis on doing the research and development. Okay. He have the knowledge of chemical and what so-called reactions, chemical reaction. They put some chemical into typical concrete and make a lot of air inside the concrete. And then his concrete can float on water. Oh, that's really nice, right? But it requires knowledge of chemistry to develop that kind of product. You may talk with him, Ajahn. Ajahn Srichai said, you are very good in lightweight concrete. How do you do it? Okay, that's basis on research and development. You may study master degree with him to further development of that. But deep down into the chemical property, you got to use very high end sophisticated instrument such as what's so called microscope. You know microscope, right? That's you learn in the biology. But this one is electron microscope or synchrotron, those kind of thing, to study the structure of the new type of concrete and understand why it's happened. Okay. This is going to be testing for scientific data. And this one you may publish in very renowned journal, right, people? And for the work, like me who do a lot of full-scale tests, it's harder to publish on this kind of journal, okay? And this one, if you prefer, most of the time, you may go to using those kind of synchrotron light to find a new innovation material such as nanotechnology cement. But most of the time, after you finish it, most of the time, it didn't go to the manufacturing because it's going to wait for a while until the technology reach its full development. Form three types of material testing. It requires method of testing. Okay. For the first one, you follow TAS or MoCo. But for the two and three, you sometimes you got to develop your own testing method. Second one, the instrument. You have to have electron microscope, okay, to study deeper into the reaction of the concrete, or you may use the synchrotron light source also. That's going to require various type of accuracy and precision. And I think one of very important one, your ability of the researcher to use those kind of instrument. And that's all for the material testing. And then we have the lab, okay? We have this one, crane, okay? If you go to F4, the crane. The crane is on top of the loading frame. We have this one in our lab. We also have universal testing machine over here, okay? And we are going to develop more testing for our structural engineering laboratory in near coming future, okay? And this one, I'm the guy who designed it in the lab, okay? It's still very useful, this one, okay? One of my PhD students study about a new type of slab. Now he is the lecturer at KMUTNB, not Bangkok. Okay. And also this one is work from Kun Kan and assistant professor Jaksada Thamlongwood. Okay. He study about precast concrete and we test it in our lab. It's kind of expensive. Okay, we got to do what? Material testing. And we have this kind of machine that can do tension, okay? Can do compression, can do fracture, can do shear test. And what the test going to follow what? This one, Thailand Industrial Standard, okay, not this one. So this one, you got to know very renowned ones, ASTM, American Society for Testing and Materials, okay? And then, before we take 5 minute break, let me take you to why do we have standard for material testing, okay? First one, to protect customer from hazard, okay? So say, if you have a bad standard for the concrete, you have a bad standard for the steel, your structure is going to be dangerous, okay? And then you got to prevent unnecessary loss in economics when you have a low quality product or chemical hazards for the cheap product. That's one going to be loss of economy. And the third one, to guide manufacturer to produce compatible product. No matter you buy steel from Sayama Yamato Steel Industry, which is one small company in the SCG group, or you buy it from the SVI, Sahavirya Steel Industry, or you buy it from the BSBM, Bang Saphan Mill, BS Bang Saphan Mill product, the all of them must pass the standard to what? To protect customer from hazards. To what? To prevent unnecessary loss of economy. And then you may see we have this kind of specific number for the TAS. And this one going to be the year. And this one going to be the name of the product. There are new product come. This is really old one. And I like you guys to remember this kind of ASTM, JIS, and BS, those kind of things. Okay? And specification must be in the with the standard, and also testing procedure. Two things come. Specification, yielding for the steel, ultimate strength for the steel, percent elongation for the steel, and modulus of elasticity, for example, for the steel. Have some set of the number. And then you got to test the steel, follow given detail in the standard, so they can compare the result. You send the steel to test at Konkan University. You test the steel, the same one, send to SUT laboratory, follow the same standard. The result supposed to be the same. Okay, that's an important thing. Okay, many picture. Oh, before the end, the TAS have two type. One is the legal type. When you have the circle around the symbol, this is the must strictly produce. And if you don't do it, it's illegal. Okay, and another one won't have the circle. For example, if you buy this pie, okay, one pie won't have this symbol. Another pie have this symbol, and then it's called the same. Which one you gonna buy? The one that have symbol, okay? At least it have something to accept it, okay? And then there are manual. You may go to the reference of this one from Siam Yamato Steel, okay? And then all of this follow the TAS. And there are various type, as I mentioned in the first slide, of steel. Which one you use? You just compare it to the yielding, to the tensile strength, to the percent elongation, and also to the E, if all of that pass is okay. And this is going to be the one that you have uses in the mechanical. So see, sorry, in the mechanics of materials, okay? This one, when you design the structure, you may use this steel table to select a proper one. When we design steel section, we design for what? The S. This called what? Okay, this called section modulus, but they use different symbol to be the C. That's nice to get this kind of answer. Okay, just compute it and select. If you get the number of S to be 80, cannot use, you can use this 80. Cannot use, you can use it. Okay. And very close is going to be who of this one, right? You select the lighter one. Which one is lighter? You may select, if you set 80, you may select this one and this one. Which one is lighter? Which one? You set the weight, right? This is 55.5 kilogram per meter. This is 58.5. So for the lightest one, you may select this one. Okay, that's, you know, already, I believe. You are good at it, right? And that's for the review of the necessary thing related the manual testing and the theory of structure and send it to steel design and RC design later. Okay, let's take 5 minutes. Okay, have some walk, have coffee, those kind of thing, and we will start our chapter 2. Let me start our session. And before we talking anything, you know the subject of statistics, right? In Thailand, we study it in grade 12, in my generation. And during the study of the statistics, when you measure from the test different specimen with the same method okay you will get the data okay the data come from in this meaning come from the testing of specimen for example if you test the tension test for 5 specimen first you get the sigma sub y the first one to be 260 megapascal the second specimen you got 255 megapascal the third specimen you get 265 megapascal let's say only 3 specimen you have 3 data point based upon this you can determine the mean of this yielding stress right and for this one 260 plus 265 plus 255 divided by 3 the mean going to be 260 okay so the mean of this one you may say this is going to be the sigma sub y mean to be 260 megapascal and then there is the other thing this also called sample mean okay from 3 samples and you should be able to calculate from sample standard deviation over here we may call it SD there are formula to calculate it but in this subject you should be able your calculator to compute for the mean to compute for the standard deviation and for sure the multiple choice problem gonna ask you what going to be the mean from this set of data what going to be the standard deviation of this data what the meaning of the standard deviation it tell us how the data distribute okay on the left and on the right hand side of the mean large SD is not good okay since the data distribute a lot small SD is good okay so in reality basis upon we study over here we going to introduce coefficient okay of variation is going to be used the own knowledge from high school that's going to be the standard deviation divided by the mean okay small coefficient of variation is good okay large is bad that means large coefficient of variation that's going to be large SD okay no good small number is good and now let me take you to the graph over here this called histogram you know histogram right this is going to be the measure value we measure the ultimate strength and this one is the number of observation what is mean if you measure for this value you have what you have the total of 6 okay if you measure for this one 700 and what 5 you measure this for 4 it show you how the data distribute okay it help you explain about the standard deviation and then from the data you determine this one this is going to be the mean sample mean of this total of 50 data point okay and this one has a deviation of 16.2 so this one will have coefficient of variation to be 16.2 divided by 713 if you like to put it in percent just time it 100 that's going to be the percent and for the ultimate strength there are standard. Okay, the value over here should not larger than five percent. If it's less than, for example, 5%, the testing result is good. Now, let me take you important thing. When we talking about the mean, if Ajahn taking about this, there's going to be half cockpit going to have larger than the mean. And another half cockpit going to be fail. Okay, won't pass the mean. What happened, kid? In our typical material testing, we have only three specimens. So the mean is very important. But if you work for the CPAC company, if you work for the TPI company, you got to check your manufactured product. That means you may test a number of specimens like this one. If you sell this material with the mean over here, you guarantee it, you're going to get 713 ultimate strength for this steel. If you sell it, half of your product will return back. Because when you test it, it's going to be only passed by half. There are some statistics for CUR thinking about reduce this one, by what? By X bar minus CSD. Okay, this C can be 1. If this is going to be 1, okay, it's going to be over here. It's going to be 713 minus 16.2. It's going to be what? 600 something, right? It's going to be this value. If you sell it by specify this value, what happened? Your product will pass this value more. Okay, so when you sell with 600 something, your product will return back less. Okay, again, I will explain to this thing later again. If you guys sell it more, like to have it to return its back more, minus 2 and 16.2, this is going to be the value about here. Again, you can see your product that sell, if you use this value, the return product gonna get smaller. Okay, and then we're talking about by using the concept of normal distribution later. Okay, normal distribution later. Now, measurement have random error. If Ajahn provide a vernier to you and measure the thickness of the rubber band from the laboratory number 2, believe me, 5 of the people in your group should have different value. Okay, those kind of measurement from the people is one of the example of the random error. And there are also things about random error is maybe due to the imperfection of the testing material. Okay, you machining the specimen and the diameter of the specimen for one example, or for one specimen, will be different from the second specimen. And you will have that in the laboratory number 2. The same steel specimen, but 2 of them. When you measure the diameter, you should not get the same diameter. Okay, there are some errors in the machining. And then they also have the imperfect of the installation of your specimen into the machine also. And then maybe you are measuring your vernier. You have not appropriate or proper knowledge to read the Vernier. That's also maybe the random error, and then the other thing else. Now, we have the machine over here. Okay, this is going to use in the next laboratory, number three, and you gonna have that kind of random error to make discussion of the result. For sure, you may just ask, machine is bad. Sometimes you should say, my measuring bad also. Okay, the error come from many things. And then we have to go to the tension test on lab number three. We're going to measure the force. We're going to measure the elongation or measurement must be done carefully in order to get a correct stress and correct strain and get the correct stress strain diagram. For example, over here, we have five steel coupon, okay, specimen. And then you can see they won't have the same plot, okay? Each coupon or each specimen have their own stress strain diagram. So when you measure for the yielding, you got to do the average. So this is going to be the mean of the yielding stress. And also the ultimate stress, you will get the mean copkit. And I believe you can do it. For this one, for the concrete, okay, T-type copkit. This is the concrete with C18 first group. This is C25 for second group. And another one is C32. What I'm showing over here, each group should close to each other because the design of the mixed design of each concrete is the same. Okay. Okay, and then you can see the result separate into three groups clearly. And now come to what the concept of mean, sorry, and standard deviation. I just mentioned the mean, you know how to compute it. Assignment, how to use your calculator to compute for the mean. If I given you 10 data points now, we have the histogram. This is going to be histogram that I just mentioned. And typically, this histogram have normal distribution. Again, come to the concept of mean. What is mean by the X bar half passes, another half one passes. And the concept of engineer over here, we're going to reduce what you're going to sell by X bar minus one, what so-called SX, you get 6.10. And you can see what passing, what you sell, gonna get bigger. To make it more reliable, you get this one. That's going to be X bar minus two SX. You get larger area of this histogram to pass it, okay? And to make sure all of them will pass it, you may use the value only 665 to sell your product. You advertise your steel only have ultimate strength of 665. Recall from TAS. All the data yielding ultimate modulus of elasticity percent elongation must pass together the whole data point. Okay, this one only the ultimate strength. If you sell it for 665, you can see most of the area passing it. That means this is a good one, right? This is a good one. Okay, should I use not only X bar minus 3 SD, SX, sorry. If I use X bar minus 4 SX, sure, you may use it. And this one gonna be more reliable. You will sell things without any failure, okay? Statistically, this kind of analysis based upon sample mean and sample standard deviation. You just put it into your calculator. You will get X bar, and then you also get SX. Okay, and then what Ajahn said, this is X bar minus XX. Okay, you're gonna get 84%. How you get it? We use the concept. Let me put this one over here. Okay, I will use that concept later. Let's see. At this point, you can compute X bar and SD. And then for using the X bar minus XD, X bar minus 2S, sorry, SX, X bar minus 3SX, we will be talking about this later. And then come to the coefficient of variation, the standard deviation divided by the X bar. Okay, is the primary indicator show the reliability of the test? Okay, if from the previous one, what did you get? The ultimate strength of steel. We get what from the table over here? 16.2 and 7.13. So this is going to be 16.2 and 7.13 and times 100. What did you get? What did you get? This is passing the standard of 5%. I think it's true passes. You got only 2.2%. So the test result from the previous histogram is what? Acceptable. Okay, lower than 5%. Now, let me move you a bit. All the data must be followed that. And for this data set and assignment, go back to your home and put it into your calculator. You should get the sample mean. You should get the same standard deviation. And for this set, you have what? You have this one going to be what? This one is what? This one is the yielding, right? This one is what? I didn't see it. This one, buckling. Okay, buckling don't have in the table. It's okay. Okay. Coming to what Ajahn put the histogram into my student score and trying to do the grading. If Ajahn said, I had the student at this point. Okay, that's at what? S mean, right? So 50% has. 50% won't pass. Ajahn is really high, like to have more students who pass it. Ajahn should have some statistical explanation to our faculty. See, based upon what Ajahn used, what so called X bar minus SD. If Ajahn use X bar minus 1SX, okay, 84.1% student will pass. Oh, that is going to be a proper number. So, Ajahn Srichai, you should cut the F at 32. Okay. If Ajahn proposes, let me cut it at X bar minus 2SX, the passing going to be 97.72. The faculty said that is too much, Ajahn Srichai, because 24 is too low. Okay. Too low. Okay. It's not proper. Based on your grading, you have what? You have examination for 100. If you cut over here, it's called 1/3. Okay. That makes sense. Okay. This one is going to be 2/3 to be 1/4. The score of the 100. Okay. Now, this concept can be used if you know about normal distribution. By using normal distribution, n going to be kind of large number for this one, and going to be like 200 something student, and then following this one, you got to change the horizontal axis. From what you have is score, okay, the score on this one, you got to change it into the variable of C. That's going to be the score of X minus mean divided by standard deviation. Don't need to understand this one, okay? And then by using statistical derivation, you get the function of F sub C, okay? When you plot this one, you will got this curve. This is going to be F sub C, and this is going to be the C. You just change the data, follow the given set of equation, and then what you get? The whole area of this bell shape of normal curve. I call this one bell shape, okay? Bell shape. The total area is going to be 1.0, okay? I don't believe it. Don't worry. You just do the integration of F subset DZ from minus infinity to positive infinity. When you integrate the function, you get the area under the function, right? So if you integrate this one, you will get the area of this one equal to 1.0. You can prove it, okay? Use the Mathematica, use the MATLAB, those kind of computer program. And then you may plot the graph, use this function as the horizontal axis. Use this function as the vertical axis. You get this one. Now, at the mean, okay? You get it at the middle. For the mean, set equal to 0. Going back over here, okay? For the mean, set equal to 0. So this is gonna be X bar sample mean minus critical mean divided by critical standard deviation. This one gonna be 0. So C is 0. See, at the mean, when sample mean put into this function, C is gonna be 0. Okay. Now we introduce the concept of reliability. Okay. If you put this one, reliability of the mean is going to be this area. Reliability of the mechanical property used in the structural design. Okay, for this one is going to be half-half because reliability is going to be one minus probability to failure. Okay, from this one, probability to failure is going to be this area. Your eye is going to be floating. Okay, don't worry. It's always something like this one. Okay. But the concept go to my very first slide of this chapter 2. Okay. We talking about what value we should use for a given manufacturer to sell the product. Okay. Not the mean. Because when we talking about the mean, half pass, half won't pass. Okay. Now, when you move into this one 50, this one 50. When you put into over here, all the area, the red and the light green, combination of them gonna be the total of 84.1%. Let's say you call it, that's from one. That's going to be 84.1%. And if you get left to minus 2, this C, minus 2, you get more area. That means 97.4 going to pass this one. And then if you use this minus 3, 99.865 going to pass it. And then they produce it into the table, okay, by using the mean, the reliability is 50. The probability to failure is 50. when you use mean minus one standard deviation 84.1% reliable and only 15.9 is the probability to failure. And then if you move far to the left with this mu minus 2 sigma sub y, 97.72 pass, only 2.22 won't pass. And then if you move further to the left, mean minus 3 standard deviation, 99.865 reliable, and only 0.135 fail. Let's see, probability of failure, fail. And if you go further to mean minus 4 times of standard deviation, 99.996 ST fail, or only 0.00317%. This one passed, sorry, this one passed, and only this one failed. And when put it in the ratio, this is 1 out of 2 fail. This one, 1 out of 6 fail. This one, 1 out of 44 fail. Based on this one, 1 out of 740 fail. If you minus by 4 of the standard deviation, only 1 of 31,600 fail. Okay. So if you move to the left, the given where you are ultimate strength get lower, but the reliability of your product gonna get larger. So we come to example for this one. And for 131 specimen, okay, you have the sample mean of this one, 794 megapascal. And then the standard deviation of 38.6. Now, it has the normal distribution. And then you like to estimate the yielding stress of the reliability of 99%. What is mean? They're going to be one fail out of 100. Okay. So coming to the table, what is going to be the reliable of 99%? Reliable is here. And this is 99%. And 1 out of 100 fail. That's related to the mean minus 2.33 standard deviation. And it's very simple. Just put this given value, mean, and standard deviation over here, mean over here. So if you sell your material with the yielding of 704, only 1 out of 100 sale gonna back to your company. Okay. And for sure, this one is going to be your multiple choice question. And this kind of problem is very easy. Okay. And if the specimen is lower than that, very limited specimen, there is one size tolerance limit. And I won't cover this one in examination, but I should say, based upon that, they introduce not only reliability. Now, it said that's 99% reliability. What the confident you are, okay? If the number of specimen N is very large, okay, the confidence level should be 100%. But if the number is small, the confidence gonna be smaller. Okay, I won't cover this one in the midterm examination and also final. But for this one, it's based upon the equation from the Department of Defense of United States. You may compute the tolerance limit factor, okay, 99 reliability with 95 confidence basis upon this equation. And also, if we have it in table, it's going to have in this form of table. And there are example. I let you guys study it by yourself. Okay, for this example, if you are use the same example with the same 99 reliability, but you have only 95% confidence. If you put the n, the number of n, 131 over here, okay, you may compute this one to be 2.65, and then you can see this one gonna be the larger than the previous one, 2.33. And now, if you use this kind of United States Department of Defense in the calculation, you advertise gonna be only 692 megapascal. Okay, smaller than before. Okay, but sure. Okay, your product gonna be more reliable with 95% confidence. Okay, okay, that's all for the lecture of chapter 2. Let me move you to briefing of the next laboratory. This laboratory number 3, tension test of steel and cast iron, is going to take a lot of times to finish it. Okay, you may finish again the lab at 6 p.m. Okay, what we going to do, going back to what you have in chapter 3 of the mechanics of materials, okay, we're talking about the stress strain diagram, and based upon this one, we have this one as the strain, this one as the stress, and then the stress, I didn't upload it. I will today. This is going to be P over A. This is going to be delta over L. Actually, what I'm showing guys over here already have in the chapter 3 of the mechanics of material. I just take it in the shorter one. Okay. And then we have learning objective to understand the mechanical behavior and mechanical property of the steel and cast iron. What the behavior? Like the ductile, okay, behavior. Brittle behavior. So brittle behavior supposed to be for the cast iron. The ductile behavior supposed to be on the steel. Okay. And not only that, if you plot the stress strain diagram from the steel, the graph should be something like this one. And first portion of this one express what's so called elastic behavior. Remember that, right? And the left portion of this one, we call it plastic behavior. That's talking about behavior. For the mechanical property, we have already talking about it. Sigma sub y, sigma sub pl, sigma sub u, modulus of elasticity, percent elongation, those kind of things. Okay, in the lab, you should be able to compute them. And then in the testing, we separate the test into two types. One, load controlling test. We have this one, load scale, okay? And we have the dial gauge, if you recall. If your people said, okay, this is start, and then, hey, this is 1 kilonewton, read the dial gauge. Hey, this is 2 kilonewton, read the dial gauge. This is 3 kilonewton, read the dial gauge. This one, load controlling test. Okay, you said 1 kilonewton. Hey, read the dial gauge. Load controlling test. 2 kilonewton. Read the dial gauge. 3 kilonewtons lead the devil gate, 4 kilonewtons lead the devil gate. Okay, this load controlling test is good for linear elastic behavior. Also, it's good for brittle materials because brittle material have linear elastic behavior up until failure. Now, when it reach the ultimate, okay, and then you start to note that, to note that for the previous one, the 1 kilonewton, this one have like 10, what's so called? 10 mark, 10 mark. Oh, this one, how come? I cannot write it. This one move for 10 mark, okay? For the 20, it's move 20 mark. 30, it's move 30 mark. 40, 40 mark. 50, it's move 50 mark. However, now, you're going to move 50 to 60. When you move 60 to 50 to 60, this one change to 80. It's not linear elastic, right? It's come to some special point called yielding. Okay. When it's yielding, you got to change. Now, this is 80, right? You change it to be 100. Now, this one gonna control. This one. Your friend, hey, this is 100, read the load. Hey, that's gonna be 120, read the load. Hey, it's gonna be about 20, 140, read the load. This guy called displacement controlling test. This one good for ductile material that has both elastic and plastic behavior. All of the universal testing machine selling today have this kind of displacement controlling test and measure for elastic and plastic behavior. Ajahn, why you teach load controlling test? Only for the option, okay? For to let you guys know that we have two types of testing. Now, let me move you to the detail of this one. We have the deform bar. We have two types of specimen. One gonna be the deform bar, and another one going to be the round bar. Okay, the round bar gonna have this kind of shape. And then you got to measure the diameter one time, two times, and three times. Then you have the diameter, original diameter, average. And then you can compute for the area. Okay? And now, for this one, you put your specimen, okay, over here at this point. And at this point, after that, you get this one, measure the diameter, you get it's over here. Then you got to install your dial gate over here. Then you got to first start preload the specimen to be 0.5 kilonewton, the first one, this one, 0.5 kilonewton. And now you measure this one for L sub O, and then you got to set this one to be 0. Now you are ready. Okay. And then what you do next with the green one, you increase the load from 0.5 kilonewton to 1.0 kilonewton. is gonna move over here. And then you ask your friend to read the dialogue. Okay, that's gonna be the first step. The next step, do the same thing. You move from 1 to 1.5 and ask you to read, okay, the dialogue. This is called what? Load controlling test. And the dialogue is supposed to be have the same movement. Okay, if have 4 mark, the next one supposed to have 3.5 or 4.5 mark, it's okay. Okay. And then you move this one for many times up until to 1 point. Let me put it in the example to 110 kilonewton to be 10.5 kilonewton. This one only 10 mark. 10 mark. Okay. Each one 10 mark. Each one 10 mark. Up until this one is moved to 20 marks on the dial gauge. That's going to be the start of what? Again, going to start of what? This crack yielding. Okay. And you're going to start the displacement controlling test. Now, you reach this one by this is going to be like for example 200 mark already. Now you got to set this one to be the controlling one. So you move to 220 mark, okay, and then you read the load over here. You move this one to 240. You read the load over here. You move this one to 250. You read the load over here. That's called displacement controlling test. And you run the displacement controlling test until the failure of the matrix. Okay. That's going to be what you have. And then during this one, you got to plot the diagram. And then the diagram supposed have to have the rough scale and fine scale. Okay. And then you should be able to determine the mechanical property. I won't do any explanation. You have it in the chapter 3 of mechanics of material. And then discuss about all the behavior and the mechanical property. Compare the mechanical property with the reference one, such as one that I show you from SYS. Okay. And then you got to check for the necking and the fracture. When does the let's say if this one fail, okay, let me put this one fail. When the structural fail, you will hear the click, okay? Not loud, but it's a bit loud, okay? And then you move the specimen reaching each other, and then you measure this one for L sub O. And when it's reached, you lower down it and reach it. You measure one, this one to L sub F, and this one for D sub F. This D sub F, you compute for A sub F, the fracture area and the fracture length. Now, you come to the point. After this one, you have all these mechanical property. Okay, there are ductile material and brittle materials. Okay, we measure the ductile material and brittle material based upon percent elongation. After you measure the L sub F, you put L sub F over here. Okay, minus L sub O. You get percent elongation in the positive. Typical steel should have about 20% elongation. We have another thing called percent reduction of the area. You put A sub F into this equation, the result gonna be negative. The ductile material may have this one for 50% area reduction. Okay, but for the brittle materials, the percent elongation close to zero and the percent reduction of area also close to zero. Okay, so for the brittle material, we have very small yielding and the failure gonna be suddenly failure, sudden failure or what's so called immediate failure. For the ductile material, you may see large deformation before the failure. Okay, very large deformation. You're going to spend a lot of time on the steel, but you're going to spend very short time for the cast iron. Okay, and then finally, you just get this one for the cast iron. It have no yielding. Okay, you may use 0.2% offset to determine the yielding, but most of the time, it won't have it. Don't worry. Okay, just linear elastic to failure. And then for this one, why the brittle material fail like that? Because cast iron have carbon inside the material and there are micro crack. When you pull it, micro crack open, the area reduce very quick. So it have kind of brittle failure. When you compress it, the micro crack close to each other, and then there is the Poisson effect. This one just bug out, okay? And then the material can take larger force. So in compression, the cast iron can take very large compressive force over here. And most of the cast iron used to what? Used for the rail, okay, for the railway. And then the railway have the steel wheel over here. So most of the time, the cast iron subjected to compression, it have a very good ability to resist compression. So it's good for this kind of application. Okay, and for the necking, okay, the steel subjected to tension, but due to the necking, is the slippage of the plane of the steel grain. It has what? It's occurred by the shear stress. So steel fail by the shear stress under the tension. And the evidence is 45 degree necking over here. But for cast iron, the failure just the separation of the plane of the steel grain due to the micro crack expand quickly under tension. Okay, so the cast iron fail by tensile stress and at the 90 degree. And believe me, all of this gonna be included into our examination today. May have 10 or 15 question onto that one. And then in the lab, this is going to be the failure of cast iron, and this is going to be the failure of the steel. A good one gonna be this one. Okay, if there is something like this one, it's maybe like a asymmetry. And then you got to explain appearance, cracking pattern, and those kind of things in the laboratory. And this one explain about what's so-called load control testing. And on the right, that's going to be displacement control testing. And again, load control test is good only for linear elastic region. But the displacement controlling test is good for all region, elastic and plastic. And then there are data sheet in English. You guys are supposed to use it in the laboratory. Okay, thank you for your attention. And sorry, that take 4 more minutes, passing 3 o'clock.